That's not my call. Yeah, I'm trying to think about that. That's not my call. You have people say, well, I don't have that gift. I don't have a gift of getting to my church. I don't have a gift of talking to people. I don't have a gift of caring about people's soul and trying to get them saved. I don't have that gift. As if that gift, you know, the command to go into all of the world and preach the gospel is just relegated to just certain people. And most times people think it's relegated more to preaching. And maybe it's certain people in the church, but not them personally. And I think that until we can get people to understand that unless we are interested in what God is interested in, we're kind of on the wrong track. We're not going to get that far in whatever we're doing, and we're not going to succeed in whatever we are endeavoring to do. Because it's all about carrying out the will of God here on earth. How many know? Okay, somebody would ask you, what is the will of God? What am I supposed to be doing? What is my purpose? Okay, there's about five things that we can name that would probably come under that umbrella, my purpose. Anybody want to take a stab in the dark? Okay, would you rather have a glorified body or just a physical body like you have now? Amen. That's interesting because all of the saints, the church that will be called up to be Christ, they will receive what kind of body? A glorified body. But when Christ comes to the earth to rule, he's going to find real living people, human beings, and he's going to judge them. Some are going to be condemned to hell, but some going on the left hand, but on the right hand, he has come and heard the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. So that means that a lot of the people that will be upon the earth, they will have the privilege of what going directly into the millennium kingdom in their physical bodies without being glorified. And they'll reign with Christ for 1,000 years. Amen. So I would rather have a glorified body, because people during the millennium reign, they will be dying. Some of them will be dying. And some will be born. You know, people will be born and some will be dying. So glorified body means that you're not subject to death anymore. You're beyond mortality. That means you're beyond the point where you can die physically, or you can experience illness, sickness, or disease, or death. You're beyond that point. And that's the good thing. Another thing I like about glorified bodies too is that they're not subject to time or space. They can appear and disappear. Y'all came through the door today, right? But in your glorified body, you don't have to come through a door. You can just come through space. That three-dimensional wall will make room for you. You can just come through anywhere. You're not subject to anything. And if I'm here in Tulsa now, I can be in L.A. at the speed of thought. You're not subject to time or limit space or travel. Okay, so you'll be in a different form, but it will be a physical form. It just won't be all spirit. Jesus, after he rose from the dead, he was physical, because he asked his disciples to what, touch him, and he ate fish with him, right? So he was a real person. Flesh and bones. Of course, he didn't have bread. He didn't have blood. Okay. So having God's interest in heart is a big issue, because if we don't have God's interest in heart go through this life and don't be fruitful and productive, and I think that one purpose that we have for sure is to represent Christ. Be his spokesman, we are to be his ambassador, we are to speak on his behalf, we are to act on his behalf. And that's one of the purposes that we have as believers, okay? Anybody can name another purpose we have? Okay, we represent Christ. Okay, we are to be fruitful. We are to not only represent him, but we are to bear fruit. All right? If we don't bear fruit, that means that what? Nobody will get saved. And so that's the purpose of a believer. We are to go into all of the world and what? Preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. And he that believeth not shall be damned. Now, there are other... After we get people saved, we are to what? Help to get them saved, and we are to what? Help to what? To help to keep them saved.
Mm-hmm. Well, help them grow spiritually.
Right, we have to help them to grow spiritually. So that is very, very important. And there are other, but those are the main purposes that we have as believers. I guess the first purpose that we have is to fellowship with Christ, fellowship with God. Just like the husband and wife, when they or just get married, they have a desire for companionship. They have a desire to reproduce themselves through somebody else. I mean, they want a reproduction of themselves in their children. How many know that companionship is something that every mother, father, they want
that type of companionship. They want somebody that came out of them or from them, that they can what, connect to, relate to, care for, love. And that's the thing that makes a family what complete, is that companionship, love, the caring, and somebody that can carry out their dreams or their plans. So that's the reason why sometimes people get married, because they want that type of fellowship, relationship. They want to see themselves duplicated in the lives of their children. Okay. Last week we read the scriptures that Colossians 3:1-2. If ye then being risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth. Okay, so our affection are to be on things which God is interested in. The three things that we mentioned earlier that God is interested in is salvation of what? Lost soul. He wants them what? Not only saved, but he wants them what? Filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. So we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And that's the reason why we put so much focus on praying in the Spirit, singing in the Spirit, making melody in your heart to the Lord, and really fellowshipping with the Lord on a level where you can really receive the adequate anointing, the grace that you need in order to carry out the will of God. A person that doesn't worship the Lord, doesn't stay filled with the Holy Spirit, they're not going to be that motivated about our union. That's the reason why I try to get people to stop piddling around and when they worship the Lord. Sometimes you just piddle around. Okay, so people need to worship the Lord with all that they have in order to get the maximum grace or the strength or the ability to do what they're called to do. Because how many know there's power in praise?
Amen.
And another thing too, I was talking to somebody today that had some real serious injuries from working, I think, picking up things that were too heavy to strain their body and the spinal cord, and they had already had surgery on one shoulder. They need a surgery on the other one. And he says that he's in constant pain. And so I was just thinking, I say, is there anything spiritually that can be done to cause a person to experience, you know, we are healed from our spirit, from inside, outside. There's a whole lot of life to heal us in our spirit. A whole lot of life. The anointing or the charge, whatever you might want to call it, you know, our bodies are nothing but a big blab of water, you know, that coated in skin. But our body carries a big charge, electrical charge. You're full of electricity. And we got power within us to heal anything that's wrong with us. There's power in us to heal anything. And the power really resides in the spirit of man. The Bible said the spirit of man is the kindle of the Lord. All human strength comes from a man's spirit. All human strength comes from a man's spirit. Now, how many remember the Gadarene demoniac that was out in the graveyard, and he was like a madman, and he was, they tried to bind him. He was full of demons. He had over 2,000 demons in him. And they tried to bind him with chain, and I don't care how big and how heavy those chains were. When they bound him up, he would just whack, just break them just like that. he was very, very strong. So that shows you that in your spirit, man, when God is not residing there, if you leave yourself open to evil spirits, the devil can exert a whole lot of power over your life. And you can get real strong, not in the Lord, get real strong in the devil. And that's the reason why these people, I remember fortune teller that we went to one time, fortune teller, when my grandmother died. I was just a little boy. My grandmother got lost in the woods. And it's been lost for a lot of days. And we were really concerned. We had people from all over coming out looking for my grandmother. So nobody could find her after a lot of days. They went to a fortune teller and they told her exactly where she was, and she was dead. And, so you can cultivate your spirit if you are possessed by the devil. Your spirit can be cultivated. It can become real strong, and your spirit can really be powerful. Not in the Lord, but in the devil. Okay, but how much more powerful can your spirit be when you are really cultivated and developing your spirit in the Lord? Remember Samson? Samson was a strong man. He could pull down buildings like this probably with one finger or two. He was so strong. But all of his strength came from his spirit. The spirit of the Lord was upon him. So there's enough power in our spirits to do whatever needs to be done. And most times the things that we need God to do is just small compared to what Samson, he took one jawbone of an ass and killed how many Philistines? Several thousand Philistines with that just one jawbone of an ass. So he was strong. He pulled out a whole big, huge building just before he died. And all that spirit, all that power is in your spirit. Amen. So the problem is how to get the power and the anointing out of your spirit into the areas of your body that you need God to supernaturally intervene. How do you do it? Okay. By the Word of God. Confessing the Word of God. You get a scripture that lets you know that the Lord is the strength of my life. I can do all things through Christ that strengthen me. Greater is He that is in me. If you let your scriptures like that and really begin to confess scriptures like that until those scriptures become a living reality in your soul. In other words, they become rhema, they become full of life. Then those scriptures or those words have the power to do stuff. The Bible says we overcome the devil by the blood of the Lamb and the what? Word of our testimony. Now, I talk like this many times, but people just don't get it. The hardest thing is to get people to open their mouth and say, the Lord is the strength of my life. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. They don't see how anything significant or anything miraculous could come out of something like that. But that's one of the ways God has designed for us to access that power, that anointing that's residing in our spirits. And when you begin to feed your spirit words that speaks about God's ability and God's power and God's anointing, then those words begin to what? Create more anointing, more power. So confessing the Word of God is a powerful thing. It's a powerful, it's a lot in the Bible about agreeing with God in your testimony. In other words, you find scriptures that focus on things you need God to do, or things that God has already done legally,
But they're not going to become reality to you until you begin to what? Make them your own. You're going to have to what? Confess them. Agree with God. Take them out of the Bible and begin to what? Feed on them and get them down in your what? Spirit. And I've heard of so many people that can heal in school at Raymond. They said that we didn't have faith to get healed when we got here, but when we began to confess the word, He healeth all of my diseases and He forgiveth all of my iniquities. He hath borne all of my sicknesses, carried all of my sorrow. Christ has delivered me from the power of darkness, and He has translated me. They began to confess things like that, and they did it for days and weeks, and some of them even did it for months. One day, also, they are also encouraged not only to confess the word or just read it out, and so that that word can really begin to get into your spirit and become rhema, but they are admonished to pray in the spirit. See, we have a way of creating the anointing to break every yoke of the enemy. We got a way to do it, but who's going to do it? I mean, you barely on Sunday and get people to what? Meet and raise their hand. So hallelujah. They just hit one time because you told them to say hallelujah. But everything in you to turn your life around or to heal you or to make you whole is already there. And if you would just work with the word and exercise your spirit, man. See, it takes feeding, it takes eating. Amen. It takes eating, we call that feeding on the word. And it takes what? Exercising to get strong. Right? You take exercise. Alright? Now, physical exercise, the Bible says doesn't profit a whole lot spiritually, but it does profit a whole lot physically. Okay, so if a person will exercise, they will if they eat properly, they'll begin to what? Get what? Get strong. So it's the same thing spiritually. If we receive the word, begin to eat it, and the word of God, the Bible says, is life to them that what? Find it, and is healing to all of their flesh. Everything that's needed in order to correct whatever's wrong in your mind, your body, your soul, or spirit is in the word. It's already in the word. So you gotta eat it, digest it, and then you have to what? Exercise. Exercise means you got to, what do you believe exercise and refer to when it comes to spiritual disciplines that goes along with eating, feeding? How do you exercise your spirit? Exercise your spirit. Because your spirit can get strong through exercise. Confessing, that helps exercise.
Meditate.
Right, meditate.
Pray.
Praising the Lord. Right. Praying in the Spirit. That's how you what? Exercise your spirit. And that's what in this book, just turn to the first chapter on page 2. It has this, it says this, number 5, everybody on page 2? On page 2, everybody can find page 2, way back. A renowned man of faith who spent much of his life ministering to the sick and suffering made this astounding discovery. I want to tell you that when you begin to analyze the subject of sickness, you will discover that usually the difficulty is that there is sin behind it. Not necessarily that there is an act of sin or some personal sin, but more likely the laziness of our soul or the inactivity of our spirit, or the neglect of God's word, or the neglect of faith and love and prayer. Okay, so if you look at that, he says that it's not that people have committed some sin that's the root of their sickness. He says more than likely it's not necessarily that there is an active sin or some personal sin, but more likely the laziness of our soul. Okay, what do y'all mean? What do y'all get out of that? Because people are too lazy to get well, to get healed, or to get victory. People are too lazy. Okay, now, well, how would y'all explain why, you know, people don't get the results that they see because they're too lazy? What are some of the things that people just, it's kind of hard to get people to do? It's hard to get them to what? To feed on the word.
Yeah, to read the Bible.
There you go. Okay, now people come closer to what? To watching television for 3 or 4 hours, mm-hmm. 6 hours, mm-hmm. than what? Reading the Bible, even for 30 minutes. And it just comes, you know, it's kind of easier to tell the truth. It's a little easier to watch a football game or than to sit down and read the Bible. And see, if we're not interested in what God is interested in, it's going to be what? More interesting. So you can see that laziness of spirit is not only neglect of the word, but also of the neglect of what? Of prayer. And love, that means that reaching out and helping people. Whenever you can reach out and sow into other people's lives, that stirs up the anointing as well. That's an exercise.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's the way you exercise your spirit, and that gets you on fire, yeah. Cause spiritual things to become what, exciting and real, and you really begin to experience what we call the power and the anointing of the Lord. So these are some of the things that I feel that we have to look at in order for us to really understand what it means to be interested in the things that God is interested in. See, God is interested in us being on fire, the Word of God being what, alive and real, us praising the Lord. Amen. Anybody from the old school? Remember, people used to dance until they got happy?
Yeah.
Ran all over the church screaming and hollering and crying and weeping and falling out under the anointing. Prophesying and being used in gifts of the Spirit. Amen. Those were the old days, right?
Yeah.
Everybody now is real quiet and reserved.
Yeah.
And they won't say much. They won't say nothing loud.
Lazy.
All right. So if you don't do something to get your spirit in tune or active, then that means that what? You have no defense against the forces of evil.
That's right.
You have no defense. And that is the reason why usually like in healing schools, people do. They are motivated to what? Feed on the word, and they are motivated to exercise their spirit by confessing the word, praying the word, praying in the spirit, singing the word, and do everything you can to what? Enrich your spirit, so your spirit can what? Amen. Turn around and what? Make enough life to eradicate whatever what? Problem you're dealing with. All right. Am I making any sense?
Yeah.
Am I making any sense?
Yeah.
All right. So I think that, Sister Panola, we're beginning to make just a little progress in the area of motivating people to reach out and to start talking to people about coming to church.
Yeah.
Because today we had several people that came as a result of somebody reaching out. And also, I've noticed recently that people are trying to what? Open up a little bit more. And today was good, wasn't it?
Yeah,
it George, you missed it, man. It might have been your healing day. All right. So if we can get people to break and let go and let God use them and work them over and get all of this praise and the anointing that they got out, then miraculous things will begin to what?
Happen.
That's what we want, right?
Man.
How many know that when you're in a church where everybody is excited about the Lord and you can feel the anointing coming from your sisters and brothers and people are weeping, are dead serious?
Yes.
Amen. That's the thing that we are seeking for and we are asking God to restore in this church. And I believe that we are on the right road.
Amen.
But we got to what? Keep doing it, keep doing it, keep doing it, and keep doing it. All right. Praise the Lord. God bless you, brother.
Excuse me, sir. Can I use your restroom for a minute?
Sure. Okay.
All right. Thank you.
That'll be fine. Okay. All right. So in this chapter, having God's interest in heart, we went over Philippians 2, 19 through 21. But I trust in the Lord Jesus. This is the second verse on page 12. Timotheus surely unto you to send Timotheus that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. For all seek their own, not the things which are Christ, Jesus Christ. Okay, so I think we went over that the other day. On page 16, it says, having God's interest at heart, this is under the right-hand side, having God's interest at heart is not automatic, but something we must seek to know. In other words, in order to be really caught up in God, are interested in the things that God is interested in. It's not something that you just automatically what you have when you get saved. You got to do some things, pray, seek the Lord, get in Bible study, reach out to people, invite them to church. You got to do some stuff in order for that motivation to be what stirred up in your life. It doesn't come by you just coming to church on Sunday. It's something that you have to what do something to get what activated in your life. And I guess people say, well, if I gotta do something, yeah, I'm sorry. You know, sometimes people won't, you can't, you know, you can't get them no further than you can push them. Just like a wheelbarrow, it won't go no further than you what? You have to push it. Okay, so Paul was saying, he said, I got all these ministers here under my ministry. He said, but I can't find one man that have the only one man that I know of that's one of my followers that have the same type of concern for the lost and for the people of God that I have, and that was Timothy. So you have a lot of preachers around, but they're looking for what? Fame and recognition, power, glory. They want to preach till they get people happy. Makes them feel good to get somebody happy. So they just want what? They just want power, fame, and money.
So it should be more so than to get somebody saved.
Yeah.
Right. Invited,
right.
You know?
But how many people, period, is interested in people to the point where they're willing to work with them until they get them saved and filled with the Holy Spirit on a one-on-one? Ain't no money involved in that. Not a whole lot of money involved in that. But that's the way that we got started here at church. We started working with people on a one-on-one. And just like this people, brother here had a whole bunch of kids this morning. His wife was working. People like that, you're almost going to have to connect with them on a one-on-one in order to get the word in. Sometimes you get them filled with the Holy Spirit. And that is not too glamorous when you labor with a person maybe for a week or two, a couple of weeks, and you know, they don't yield right away. It might be a month or two before you get them filled with the Holy Ghost. So this is what it means to really have, to be willing to do grunt work. How many know what grunt work is? That's right.
Hard work.
Yeah. Grunt work. Work don't get no recognition. And nobody know what you're doing and see nothing you're doing. And
Nobody give you any kind of what, accolades or praise or encouragement. You just have to do it because you love the Lord. That's the kind of work that we call grunt work and real work of the ministry. So Paul was saying that I don't have anybody that will do things like that because everybody is caught up in their own thing. Whatever that thing is, that's what they were caught up in. And that's the problem that we have today in the church. You know, if I told the average preacher, I said, well, you can preach every Sunday morning, well, he'd be excited. Let's get an offering. If I told him to call somebody on the telephone and check on somebody and work with them until they get saved, that's not appealing. It's not appealing. But if they're up before people, you know, that motivates them. So, let's move on. Okay, now, now when it comes to, in this chapter we covered, you'll have to read it in order to get all these details because I don't want to just read out of the book, it's, you know, just right there. That God is interested in all, in basically three things on page 14. He's interested in the people getting saved, people receiving the Holy Spirit. That's on top of page 14D, and believers growing up spiritually. The Father's interest is in the lost. You're seeing in the verses below. And those verses need to be read. We already know God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. My favorite scripture, Romans 8:32, he that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Herein is love, not that we love God, but he loved us, sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice or the propitiation for our sin. So those scriptures show you that God is very interested in the what? In the law. Mm-hmm. And then we have a group of scriptures which show the Lord's interest, Jesus' interest in the law. Now what scripture could you refer to in this passage here that shows that Jesus is dead serious about the laws? You can just, which one of those scriptures register more to you that we have under that topic? Which one of those? Lay down my life? Okay, by the fact that Jesus what laid on his life showed that he was really what? He was really what?
Serious about it.
He was very serious to the point of what giving his life.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the Holy Spirit. Okay, what does the Holy Spirit do that shows you that the Holy Spirit is really interested in laws? So there are scriptures there under that heading too. Doesn't have to necessarily be under that heading. But the Holy Spirit, what is the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives today? The Holy Spirit does what?
It comforts us.
Mm-hmm. The Holy Spirit what? Guides us.
Mm-hmm.
What? He teaches us all things, bring all things to our what? Remember? Mm-hmm. The Holy Spirit heals us when we are sick. I mean, it's the Spirit of God. You know, that's what it is. Okay, the Holy Spirit, he does all of these things because he's what? He's concerned about our salvation and about our spiritual what? Development and growth. He's concerned about that. So the Holy Spirit is definitely interested. Now, angels, do you think angels are interested in us? Okay, well, how do you know angels are interested in us? How many got an angel? How many ever seen an angel?
Never seen one.
You felt the presence of angels, right? Because the Bible says angels are ministering spirits, and they're sent forth to minister to everybody that are heirs of salvation. So angels have a ministry. Angels protect. They look out after us, and they do stuff that when we pray, we put the angels on what? On the assignment, right? Mm-hmm. All right, so angels are what? Real people. When you pray in the spirit, pray the word, those angels began to what? Go out there and do stuff and intervene and work on your behalf, whatever needs to be done. Sometimes we be praying in the spirit, we don't know exactly what we're praying for. Just like I was praying years ago, one morning, my wife began to pray with me, and she prayed in the spirit, and then she began to sing in the spirit. And it was the first time I ever heard my wife sing in the spirit that fluently. So I didn't know what was going to happen. I didn't know what was up. Her being that excited in prayer to the point that she was singing in the spirit. Never heard it before. And I thought, you know, something bad was going to happen, serious was going to happen. But what happened was that she was praying in the spirit. So what? Really? Well, wow. John, man, we better put you up here and get some of that anointing moving. Come on, John, come on. You're holding out on us. You're holding out on us. But that same night, I was in revival. I was coming back from Bartlesville. And it was around midnight, and my musician was riding with me, and this big, huge cow just walked right across my path. Well, that could have been the last of me and my musician. And that was Brother Keith. Some of y'all might remember him, Brother John Dunn. And that prayer that morning had taken care. That was an angel. Yes, sir. God bless. Okay. Come back to see us sometime.
Okay.
Okay. God bless you.
All right.
Okay. And the car was almost demolished. Did about $2,000 worth of damage. But I wasn't shaken up. My musician, his glasses didn't fall off. And nobody was shaken up. So we got some help to pull the cow off the road, and we just kept coming. But that was the angel on the run, and that morning we had prayed and we had released those angels to what? To go out and set the stage for our deliverance. And how many times have you went to sleep at the wheel?
Oh!
What? It's gotta be angels. It's gotta be some right working.
Yeah.
Because you ain't working. You ain't working right. So they are ministering spirits. So angels are definitely what? On our side. They're working on our behalf and trying to even keep us here so we can carry out the will of God. But, okay.
Get out.
Yeah,
I was getting more sick than you are.
Just just before sometimes you make a move to experience that fatal blow, something that will just take you on to heaven.
Yeah.
Something just wake you up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Only up, but I was just driving in the day. You know how you just looking at the street, just driving.
Right.
And it's a blessing that we kept straight.
Right.
You get on the side.
Right.
And nothing like that. I'm like, wow.
So angels, amen. So the angels, ministering spirits. Okay, now the only group of people. Now we mentioned God, we mentioned the Lord Jesus, we mentioned the Holy Spirit, we mentioned angels now, and there are only two groups of people left to mention. That would be demons and human beings. Now let's think about demons. Are devils interested in the lost?
Yeah.
Are they interested in the lost?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
They want them to join, don't
they? They don't want them to live for God, right?
Right.
So they're always messing with them.
Mm-hmm.
And always putting some stumbling block in their path and leading them, trying to distract them from the straight and narrow path because they want them to be what? Lost. They're always plotting to try to get you what? Off track.
Off track.
And committing sin and going the wrong way so that they can eventually end up succeeding in winning your soul. Okay, so now it was a real good illustration in the Bible about Lazarus and the rich man and Lazarus. How many remember that when the rich man died, he lifted up his eyes, inhaled, right? And the poor man, which was Lazarus, he lifted up his eyes in what? In paradise, in heaven, you'll see today. And it was strange that those people that were down in hell, you know, of course they were screaming and crying. But if you note there that they remember their lost loved ones back in real life that they left behind. And they were trying to get Lazarus to go back in real life and warn them. Of course, that request was turned down. So that shows that people in hell are concerned about what their lost loved ones. So when you look at the whole picture, God is interested, Jesus is interested, angels are interested, Holy Spirit is interested, the devil and, you know, demons and the devil are interested, and probably when you boil it down, the ones that's not interested would be human beings. I guess some of them are unsaved, but a whole lot of them are what? Saved. But they're not interested. Does that speak well or bad on the part of believers?
Bad.
Okay, that's big, really bad. I mean, we can't afford to let these people walk around us all day and all week and never do anything in terms, you know, we might not feel up to sharing with them on the spot, but sometimes we can share a testimony, sometimes we can share a track, give them something to read, a DVD, or invite them to church, right? There is something you can do to get their attention, and I believe that it's our responsibility to what? To do it. Okay, so that is the essence of the story, and all of these fine points, you can read them. But the majority of believers are not interested in the lost. And the story on page 16 at the top, of the story of a minister reading the last rites to a convicted criminal that was to be hanged because of a cold, callous, heartless, and nonchalant manner. The last rite was ministered. The condemned criminal made this remark to the minister after hearing about his horrible fate. Okay, now this was a minister that was very hard-hearted, cold. He had no interest in this man that was convicted to die. and that this was a condemned criminal. And the criminal knew what his fate would be. You know, that means he would just go immediately into hell when he, you know, left this world. And this is what the criminal said about this cold-hearted, callous, heartless, nonchalant manner the minister demonstrated. He said, if I were a Christian and knew the horrible destiny of sinners after they die, like you do, he said, I would be willing to crawl from the West Coast to the East Coast on my knees, on glass, to save one sinner from a place of torment like you described. That indeed was a sad observation of a dying criminal. We are the only group of beings that can do something about the laws, and the only group that don't give a hoot for the most. I mean, this is not everybody, but this does include most of the people that name the name of Christ. Most people would fall under that particular category. How many agree with that? Okay, now on page 17, I want you all to read this really careful, because a lot of things I'm not going to be able to talk about. 17 at the top. Most Christians are more interested in prosperity, what else? Jobs, what else? Success, pleasure, status, romance, love, security, and recognition, more so than they are about the laws. Seven things we see from Philippians 2:19-21. Your primary responsibility as the Lord's ambassador is to promote his interest above your own goals, regardless of your circumstances. All right, that's your primary. How do y'all feel about that? Promoting the Lord's interest above your own goals? Y'all believe that will work? People say, I got goals, I got plans, I ain't got time to do all this other stuff. But how important it is for you to promote God's program over your, you know, agenda. How important is it? Okay, why do you think it's so important? That's right. That's right. That's what you're supposed to. That's the reason why God made you what you are. You belong to Christ. You're not your own, right? You bought with a price. Amen. You belong to God twice. He made you. Brought you into this world. And then what? He died for you to restore you back to fellowship. All right. So that is, you know, there's a scripture that we used to talk about. In all of our ways, acknowledge what? Him. And he shall what? So if you don't put God first, then you're kind of walking through life bland, and you might just end up anywhere. So seek ye first the kingdom of God and his what? Righteousness. And you don't have to seek things and fame. Those things will seek you when you put God first. Is that right? Just because we are born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, know the Word, Father of the Church, does not mean that we are interested in what God is interested in. That's a point that we've already shared. The majority of Christians in the body of Christ will not be interested in what God is interested in. Those interested will always be in the what? Majority?
Minority.
All right. If leaders are interested in what God is interested in and those following leadership are not, he doesn't have to stop you or slow you up as a leader even one bit. All right, the only people who will succeed in their efforts in the kingdom of God are those interested in what God is interested in, those who have laid down personal goals and ambitions and made them subservient to God's will and interest. I like number six. Christians have a responsibility of seeking out and discovering God's interest. God's interest will remain hidden until you seek it out. Setting your affections is a huge issue But it's a decision we must make. You can change your interest by a decision of your will. Amen. So that says it plainly, number six, that it's your responsibility of what? Getting interested in the things that God is interested in. Ain't nobody can pull it. I wish I could just pull it out of my pocket and just give it. Wouldn't it be easy if I could just lay hands on you and say, well, get interested, be interested in the things that God is interested in. In the name of Jesus. Just transfer that desire. You don't come. Sometimes you come, you have to pay a little price. Now, what kind of price do y'all know about people have to pay in order to get into the main flow of what God is, you know, wanting you to do? What kind of price are y'all used to hearing people talk about? People, what kind of price you have to pay, price tag you have to pay in order to get where God wants you to get so that you can really be useful in the kingdom of God? What kind of price tag y'all think that takes? Something that everybody like to do. Denying what? Pushing back what?
Pushing back the plate.
Who wants to do that? Who wants to do that? Nobody wants to do that. That might be one of the reasons why what? The things of God just don't what? Interest us. Maybe we need to what? Push back the plate and develop an appetite for what? The things of God. And man shall not live by what?
Pray alone.
But by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. I think another thing, too, would be that people don't go to church like they used to go to church. Okay, now, how many from the old school, what were the church nights like years ago? What were church nights like? I don't know. Everybody have different backgrounds. But I'll tell you what I was used to when I first got saved. How often do people go to church?
Four times.
Y'all ain't scared to say that because.
Night prayer.
Okay. You had what?
We had Monday night prayer.
All right, Monday night prayer. That's good. Okay, what else?
Wednesday Bible study.
Right, Wednesday Bible study. What else?
Oh, God, we went to church on Saturday for choir rehearsal.
Okay.
Sunday, about four. My grandmother had us sometimes every day.
Right. Okay. And sometimes Sunday night, right?
Sunday night.
We had Sunday night was just a standard time, right? Mm-hmm. The church where I came, let me see, we had Tuesday night church. We had prayer and Bible teaching. We had just church. But prayer lasts about 30 minutes. Sometimes it lasts close to an hour. And Friday night we had what? Prayer and church. We had church on Tuesday and Friday. And we had it on Sunday morning. We had Sunday school, YPWW, from the Church of God in Christ. And we had church on Sunday night. Then we had revivals. We came every night. Sometimes you were there till 11 and 12. You remember those days?
Yeah.
Okay. And now, let's compare that with what we do now. How often do we make it now? Usually, here we do Monday night, Wednesday night, but we don't do Friday night. Then we do Sunday morning, but we don't do Sunday night. So you can see, by coming Monday, of course, you know, most people don't consider prayer as a legitimate service because they don't like to do that. They don't like to pray. They don't say, I can't do that, so I'm not going to deal with it. Prayer is the smallest group you'll have. But it's my favorite service. It's my favorite service. But Wednesday night is when most people come. They come Sunday morning. They don't come to Sunday school. And, of course, in the evening time, you know, there's no service in the evening time. But, of course, we have one today because this group represents those that can't come on Wednesday. Right. Mm-hmm. So you can see how far behind, and the reason why we're drifting back is because of
the commitment, our commitment is not as strong today as it were years ago. It's kind of dwindling. And that's the reason why many times the interest in the things that God is concerned about are not like it should be. So in order to reverse that, you have to what? You have to begin to see the importance of what? If we don't come to church as much, then that means that you're going to have to do some things what on your own. You're going to have to work out these lessons and read over on your own. And that's, you know, something that is, you know, kind of challenging. People don't have take the time, you know, sometimes to do. Okay, how much interest do you think the average believer has in the thing that God is mainly interested in? The average believer, on a scale from 1 to 10, how much interest do you think the average believer, I don't know whether you consider yourself as an average believer, better than average, below average, or whatever, but how do you feel about that? The average believer, what do you think that they are in terms of being interested in the things that God is interested in? On a scale from 1 to 10.
Maybe
5. Okay. Okay, that's good. That's good. For them. You're thinking more like I'm thinking. Mm-hmm. Okay, what are you saying?
I just said maybe a 4.
Maybe a 4. Well, that's good. Okay. Well, see, so Panola probably kind of used to connect him more with like people are leaders or missionaries or people in the leadership role, and they probably would be probably more for 6. But the average person that's not ministering clan probably would be somewhere around 4. Is that good or bad? Is that good or bad?
Well,
that's
four.
Not good enough.
No. No.
It's okay.
At least you're hanging in there, huh?
Yeah.
Barely hanging in. All right. Okay, well, that's good. How many leaders and ministers do you believe are really interested in the law? He said,
whoa.
Boy, it's kind of hard to find one, right? That's genuinely.
Exactly.
It's kind of hard.
Going back to what you had said earlier, some of them are just out for fame.
Yeah, right.
And prestige.
That's it. You know, in Paul's day, Paul said that of all of the entourage that went around with him, traveled with him, and supposed to be pastors and ministers and evangelists, he said, I can't find nobody that has the same mindset I got. But Tim, I mean, that was way back there, George, that was way. So I guess the devil has done his job on people's mind to cause people to kind of divert their attention away from the things of God, but the things that pertain to them, things that will give them more recognition, give them a spiritual advantage or a natural advantage or a material advantage. So that's really, really unfortunate. And, you know, I was just asking y'all now, how many people do you know you feel that are genuinely interested? Now, how many pastors do you think that would go through his congregation and say, well, I got 30-some people showing up on Wednesday night, and we got 25 people I can't connect with because a lot of the time they're working, and you know they got conflicts in their schedules, and got, you know, reasons why they can't be here. What would the average preacher say?
He won't worry about that. Okay, we got conflicts
in the
schedule. Let's go to Wednesday night.
Yeah, that's right. All right, so I got a good turnout. I got more than half up here. He would be perfectly content. Some of them are perfectly content with just 3 or 4 on Wednesday night. A 10. All right. Do you think the church
places enough emphasis on believers growing up spiritually?
I just put a statement down.
Okay, what do you have?
Our commitment is not as strong today as it was, as it used to be.
Yeah, right, okay, right, okay. Okay, so if a church is really interested in people growing up spiritually, what things would they be advocating or pushing or recommending or stressing? What type of things that, what would they be doing more than likely if they were really interested in people growing up spiritually? Make sure everybody's filled with the Holy Ghost. Some churches, they don't care whether you're filled with the Holy Ghost or not.
Fair enough.
So,
Pastor, can I just say that sometimes you have to have one-on-one with
right.
someone, because you mentioned the young men,
right.
the children,
right.
and I don't know, something in my spirit today told me that this young guy is seeking,
yes.
you know,
mm-hmm.
and I don't know if maybe I should introduce myself, talk to him,
mm-hmm.
and just let him know
mm-hmm.
it's okay.
Right, right,
know,
right.
It's okay. And just, I guess it's a one-on-one thing that I need to do with mm-hmm. someone, too.
That's good. That's good. I had a chance to visit with him in the back, and I found out that he has a lot of needs. He has a big family. He has no income. Wife was not able to be here today because she's working. She's the only breadwinner in the home. And his heart is heavy.
Yeah.
So people like that, they need a lot of help. A lot of, admonition.
You know, you keep saying old school. I feel like I'm an old schooler. And that's what I was brought up as.
Right.
Feel someone or know that
right.
someone needy or in need,
mm-hmm.
me as a Christian, I should be there with them.
Right.
You know, I should go and say, is there anything I can do?
Mm-hmm.
Come, pray with me. We can get over this together.
There you go.
And that's how I feel like I was brought into the church,
mm-hmm.
and my grandmother raised me as Church of God in Christ. So we was always finding someone that needing help,
mm-hmm.
and that's how we endured or brought up the church. We just
right.
kept going out,
right.
ministering to people, helping people, and bringing them to church with us, and that would build our church up right there.
There you go. That's the old school.
Oh. I love the old school. This guy was seeking something, but I just couldn't put my hand on it.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't want to come up and just be obnoxious to anyone.
Right, so, right.
But the Spirit was telling me I need to go and see what I can do to help this couple,
mm-hmm.
with children. I love children.
Right.
So I need it. But
right.
hopefully he'll come back and visit them again. I want to go to school.
So did you ever teach kids? Small kids?
No. Had a daycare before. But
really? How did daycare?
I've had a daycare for about 2 years.
Everybody, this is Sister Butler. Your first name?
Joyce.
And this is Sister Manolo Washington. This is Brother George Washington. This is Brother John over there.
Yeah.
But we just really appreciate y'all. And excellent.
Amen.
So we're going to let y'all go now. Let me ask y'all, what are we going to take home from this study tonight? What are we going to take home?
I know for me, I'm taking home that I need to seek more spiritual than God.
Mm-hmm.
So that way he can work through me and I want to be able to work through someone else.
Right. You want to help somebody?
I want to help someone. I want to be able to
So you don't see that the church is a place where we just come on Sunday?
No, sir.
And just occupy the seat and get all we need. You know, everybody's, you know, they just want, I want to be blessed.
If we don't have it, then someone else is not going to get it from us.
Right, right. All right, right. That's good. She's going to take that back home.
All right, so I'm saying. Always keep God in that heart.
I am.
You know, think a lot about it. Mm-hmm. Take heart to it and deal with the issues, because when you fuck it up, it, you know, really worked on me a lot. It stayed on my mind. Like, oh, you know, what you were talking about is this true discipleship and having God in just that heart and what we're really supposed to do.
Right. That's good. Now, you're going to notice that in your work routines, job, you know, connections and things of that nature, you're going to meet people that you will be able to connect with some kind of way. Sometimes it's kind of difficult just walk up to people, invite them to church, or say something spiritual, or witness to them, or give your testimony. But most times you have to wait until the door is open. Okay? So you know at the right time, people will really want respond to whatever you have to offer. Okay, now, y'all know under what conditions the door will be open for you to say the right thing, or to invite them, or to offer a helping hand. Okay, under what conditions do you feel like the door will be open in order for you to connect with people, to be able to witness to them in a, you know, in a way that will attract them? Under what condition do you think that people are always open? Just something in the news, or the weather, or just anything. Y'all, you can ask them about their family. Right, ask them about their family.
Well, yeah, that's the first thing. You know, sometimes I do, like, talk to them. I talk about, well, I got some guys down there to play. I talk to them about sports.
Yeah, sports is a good thing.
And then I flip it. You know, I say, well, some of them go to church, some of them.
Yeah, right, right.
So I leave it alone. They say they don't go to church, they don't believe in God. I moves around. Because when the person say that and stuff, and they don't believe in God and stuff, I don't. That's a bad vibe to be around.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
you have to kind of wait for the right time for that. That's good, that's good. You can talk about sports, or you can just wait and, you know, talk enough for them to start talking about some of the things they're going through. It'll always come out if you talk to them long enough.
They'll open up a little bit too.
There you go.
Let you know.
And you show concern about what they're dealing with, and just offer, you know, any way I can help or some consolation. Tell them you'll pray for them. And that will kind of endear them to you, draw them to you. Then after you kind of draw them in, but you got to really show concern about what they're dealing with, rather than talk about yourself. And once you can kind of get their attention and they really begin to, you know, be attracted to you, or lack the compassion that you are demonstrating toward them, then you can say, I wonder if I could invite you to a Bible study at a church where you can get more information. You know, sometimes it might be a track or a little book that deals with
is a way that you can get into the hearts of people. And once you get into their hearts, then the chances are you will be able to make a spiritual impact on them. Okay, Brother George?
Well, Brother Frank, you know, he go to church.
Uh-huh.
He grew up in church, too.
Right.
You know, but he told me today, he said, I just didn't want to go to church. And I was like, well, I understand that. You know what I'm saying? You don't want to go sometimes. You don't feel like going because you ain't going to get the, you know, you ain't going to get fed
mm-hmm.
in the word and stuff because you don't want to be there, you see? So you might as well not go.
Mm-hmm.
See? That's what I told him. I had to tell him never because
mm-hmm.
he said, well, what happened to you? I said, I didn't go to church because I was feeling bad. That's why, you know, I'm still sleeping on the pill.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, so I talked to him about it. And so, you know, he said, well, he kind of go to the church down there where we stayed,
mm-hmm.
down there. So I was like, that's good. Ain't no problem, you know.
Mm-hmm.
As long as you're saved and all that. He said, yes, he's saved.
Mm-hmm.
You know, his mama, his daddy, all of them went to church.
Mm-hmm.
You know, his mom, dad's gone. But his mom still living.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he said he goes to church.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, he said there ain't no problem with that. He just said he didn't want to go today.
Mm-hmm. You're right.
I left alone.
Yeah, left alone.
As long as you say, you know,
mm-hmm.
you just didn't want to go to church. You didn't want to go to church.
You're right, you're right. Well, you know, sometimes it's difficult to get people interested in things when they don't have it in them, you know, to do it.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes it just take a while for them to be exposed to different things or either wait for something, a challenge or some type of problem result, then that kind of changes.
Mm-hmm.
Anything that they can latch on to, mm-hmm. any kind of help, anything that promises them some kind of resolution for their problem, they're very open.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes when you just, you know, just be casual, talk to people, and if you just hang in there talking to them as casual friends,
mm-hmm.
one of these days they're going to have a critical
mm-hmm.
problem. Something's going to come up where they're going to need the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then they will come to you. They'll welcome your prayer,
mm-hmm.
your advice,
mm-hmm.
and even invitations where you can help to get them to people that could, you know, that can help them. So the day will come. So I think it's all in building relationships with the people, and don't move too quickly into trying to get them to swallow whatever you are trying to, you know, get over. Just be patient, loving, do everything you can. And somebody said one drop of honey will catch more flies than a gallon of vinegar. One drop of honey. So, everybody's looking for love, right? Somebody that's concerned about their dilemma, whatever they're going through. All right, well, okay, well, we're going to take this back home, take
yeah.
more home, take something back rather than your book. All right, I just want to raise up a bunch of soul winners. But we have to start with point zero, start with the ground floor, sowing seeds for people to get interested in the thing that God is interested in. It's going to happen. Amen. You'd be surprised at how tonight you're going to be able to build on what you learned tonight. All right, that's all. Amen. I'm not going to keep you for prayer. We had a good prayer today. That was powerful today. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you tonight as we leave this place. We leave knowing that you are the strength of my life. You are the light of my salvation. We are complete in you. Thank you for all of those that have come to be a part of this service this evening. Father, we thank you that you who begun the good work shall continue to perform it. In Jesus' name, we pray that you would lead and direct and guide us and help us to become more and more interested in the things that you are interested in.
Yeah.
We'll give you praise and the glory. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, you can work out number chapter 3. Make sure that you
go through chapter 2 thoroughly and have all your questions written, the answers written down to your questions, and we'll move forward next week.